Love this podcast? Support it and sponsor today. Simply head to auscastnetwork.com for details.
Wavelength.
You know, Adelaide has worked really hard over the last few years to build a small bar reputation. When I was a kid, the big night in Adelaide was kind of, you know, staying at home and watching the bill.
Sparking the combos about Adelaide.
As a female sparky, I did get lots of comments on my gender.
You should be having...
I'm here to make a difference.
Yeah, make the difference. Give the youth a voice.
On Fresh 92.7.
Welcome to Wavelength, sparking the convos about Adelaide you should be having. I'm your host David and welcome back to 2020, the most insane year on record. Today is Monday, May 11th, which means in Adelaide some of our coronavirus restrictions are easing. While it's mostly just small stuff like being able to dine outdoors at cafes and restaurants, really this is emblematic of things starting to get better. We'll be letting you know everything that you need to know about what's changing with coronavirus restrictions later in the show, but we've also got some other pretty amazing stories for your listening pleasure this evening. This week on Wavelength, we're exploring how Australia's economy might bounce back in the wake of COVID-19. We've been exploring previously about how the coronavirus has affected the local and national economy, but it always pays to think about the future. With the current economic model basically on pause, we're going to be speaking with some economists about what opportunities there are to radically reshape our own futures. More on that later. But next, we're asking, does internet piracy actually fund terrorism? You're listening to Fresh.
Wavelength, sparking the convos about Adelaide you should be having on Fresh 92.7.
Remember those ads before movies beginning and pleading you not to download things illegally? To be honest, I don't think they had much of an effect on me personally. They made piracy look pretty cool, actually. Anyway, it seems as if they actually did have a point to make. It's something that sounds kind of absurd, though. Piracy funds terrorism. Surely that isn't true. We sent Anthony out to find out the truth, uncover the secrets of internet piracy, and determine once and for all whether these terrifying tales spun by copyright owners were legit or not.
Wavelength on Fresh 92.7.
Being forced to stay at home now, I finally had the chance to sit down guilt-free and watch one of my favourite DVDs from childhood. But before the movie even started, I heard some very alarming information in the anti-piracy ad.
The pirates are out to get you.
Not this part.
Piracy funds terrorism and will destroy our development and your future enjoyment.
There. 18 years ago, the Federation Against Copyright Theft gave us a very clear warning, which may have gone by completely unnoticed. Could it really be true? I sat down with Laurie Flexer from Creative Content Australia, who explored this, as well as the impact piracy has on the arts industry and the people who stream and download illegal content.
After the introduction of subscription services like Netflix and Stan, Australia started to see piracy rates reduce, and that was in around 2015, from previous highs of around 30% of adult Australians pirating. But sadly, we're starting again to see a rise in piracy incidents. And international research is showing that the coronavirus stay-at-home orders are really having a significant effect on piracy, with massive increases in visits to pirate sites.
What effect is piracy having on the arts industry?
Recent studies are showing that by 2022, movie revenue lost to worldwide piracy will rise to between $4 to $6 billion. But it's complex to look at revenue just in terms of the lost revenue from a single title, because not every pirated copy of a film means a lack of sales at the box office. I think it's often more about the erosion of investor confidence in the creative industries. So if investors feel that they'll not realize a reasonable return on their investment, they're unlikely to finance any screen content or music. And with less funding, obviously fewer films and TV programs are made, and this results in less jobs for industry professionals, but it also means fewer content choices for consumers. I think the key is that consumers often don't believe that their individual activity makes a difference, but every little bit does. And piracy is not a victimless crime. It's not just rich Hollywood producers or, you know, overpaid movie stars who are suffering. In fact, they are the least likely people to be affected by piracy. It's more the average people, you know, your cinematographers and your makeup artists and your caterers and the people who build the set and who supply the timber to build the sets, those are the people whose livelihoods are in jeopardy.
What risk does piracy pose to the people who commit it?
Well, the greatest risk, as our CCA's most recent research shows, and in fact the trend that we've been seeing for years, are that there are significant cybersecurity risks associated with pirate sites. So Australians who access pirate sites experience a greater amount of hacks and computer viruses than non-pirates. So for example, in our research, 25% of people that we call casual pirates, who pirate once a month or more, tell our researchers that they've experienced malware issues. But 42% of the more frequent pirates admit to cybersecurity issues. So, you know, you're almost doubling your risk the more you pirate. And bear in mind that those pirate sites exist to make money. They're not there to just kindly provide consumers with free content. So these site operators turn to illegal sources of revenue, pretty much selling out their users to criminals seeking to get access to consumers' personal and financial information. So in most of the cases, the service for these pirate sites are located offshore, which makes it almost impossible for local law enforcement authorities to find and prosecute the criminals behind them.
Now, the question we're dying to hear the answer to, does piracy fund organised crime and terrorism?
It is absolutely true that pirate sites are often funded by organised criminal groups, and often those groups are also involved in activities such as terrorism. And this has been proven by a number of international global studies by organisations like the Intellectual Property Office of the European Union. So how they do it is that by clicking on a film and TV link on many pirate sites, those sites give access to that user's computer to criminal gangs, and this exposes their personal and financial data. And this can be used in a range of ways. Those people could use it to siphon funds out of your account, or to launder money for criminal gang, or used in ransomware attacks where your computer could be locked by those criminals and you'd be required to pay a ransom to get your data back. Some sites even allow for drive-by downloads where you don't even have to click on an actual link. The malware is uploaded to your computer as soon as you just visit the site. Australians now have access to an incredible range of film and television content, not only by going to the movies, but services like Foxtel and free-to-air TV and the growing number of subscription services. And there's absolutely no need to put your own cybersecurity at risk.
Wavelength on Fresh 92.7.
That there was Ant speaking with Laurie Flexler from Creative Content Australia about internet piracy and the broader effects of it beyond just stealing copyrighted material. It's quite amazing, but certainly not shocking, that piracy has spiked during social distancing. There's not a lot out there to do right now. It actually does make me feel kind of bad that a torrent I downloaded years ago could have funded legit terrorists, which is truly insane. But do you know what is free and doesn't fund terrorism? The Wavelength podcast, which you can stream wherever you get your podcasts. Just a cheeky plug right there. Up next, we're going to be getting into our main story for this evening about the economic future of Australia post-COVID-19.
Wavelength.
Over the last few weeks, we've been investigating how Australia has totally changed because of COVID-19. Music festivals have been canned, we're in the middle of a major unemployment crisis, and businesses are having to make extremely difficult choices. But what does the future hold? During times like this, of major international upheaval and change, it's pretty easy to focus on what's happening right now. What do we need to worry about tomorrow? What's in the news today? And am I personally threatened? But it pays to look to the future too. Right now we have the perfect chance to think about not what Australia is right now, or was in the past, but what it could be in the future. There's plenty of ways to improve how we live in Australian society, but it takes some imaginative thinking. Tonight, Amila has prepared a brilliant two-part story about the future of Australia's economy. First, we'll be looking into what our relationship with China will look like. Both Australia and China rely on each other, but that amicable relationship is under stress right now as we ramp up calls for an investigation into the origin of COVID-19. Amila has spoken to Professor Hans Hendrischke, a professor of Chinese business and management at the University of Sydney Business School. He leads the Business School's China Research Network and chairs the Business and Economics Cluster of the University's China Studies Centre. Let's hear that chat right now.
Wavelength on Fresh 92.7.
With Australia brought to a standstill since the threat of COVID-19 was introduced, there is a constant debate about what this will mean for our political diplomacy and economy. Tied to China in a number of ways, Australia has suffered a heavy financial loss in tertiary education as borders continue to be closed. I'm joined by Professor of Chinese Business and Management at the University of Sydney, Hans Hendrischke, who talked to me about how COVID-19 has impacted Australia's relationship with one of our biggest trading partners. So how has COVID-19 impacted our economic relationship with China?
In several ways. There's a number of practical implications that came about simply because of the lack of transport. Neither could we receive goods coming in from China for some time. Then Chinese factories, of course, were closed, so there's a backlog. Orders to come in. These, on the other side, major parts of our exports have continued. We had a rise in iron ore exports, for example, during the early period, as much as we have figures at the moment. So the impact at the moment is more that we can't communicate. There's no way for people to travel. So that's blocking development. And of course, on a more policy-oriented side, there has been an awareness of how much we depend on Chinese supply chain, especially in pharmaceutical goods, medical equipment, and so on. So that will lead to consequences on what we have to do and what the Australian response will be.
So you don't see major exports to China, such as iron and food, changing during this time?
No, I think iron ore, coal, our really big export item will not change very much. They might even increase. Agriculture might be impacted, I think, not so much on the demand side, but it could be on the supply side, depending on how we in Australia domestically get out of the post-corona period. The third part is education, of course. That is an area where we could have a relatively quick recovery, it would have a positive impact.
Do you think there would be a definite push for this, considering that education is our third biggest export?
Well, it's one. There's two parts really to the networks, really you could say, to the importance of education. One is it's one of our biggest export items. Education is bigger than all of agricultural exports together. We tend to overlook that sometimes. So that's the export side. The other side is what does it do for local employment, local services. So it has a very big impact on the domestic economy. And the third point is it's something that actually ties Australia economically to China in a positive aspect, as China needs to train people overseas to have a global and highly educated workforce. So Australia is a big part of that.
If China's economy struggles to bounce back, what do you think that will mean for Australia?
Well, China's economy will bounce back because as a state with more control over the economy we would have in a full market economy here, they will invest in infrastructure and try to run programs. So I don't expect that recovery process and all the obstacles they encounter will have a big impact on Australia. What could have an impact is their export and their trade with the United States. That might have a global impact, and then, of course, we would be affected by that.
Do you see Australia's trading focus shift elsewhere in the long term?
That's a story which I think has been presented very much as Australia has put all eggs into the China basket, which is really a misconception. Australia has not put all eggs in the China basket. Simply the fact that China is by far the largest customer and has the biggest demand for Australian goods. So we couldn't really say we've deliberately sent all our iron ore to China and not to other places, because other places don't have the demand for it. So we depend on Chinese demand. China is a very big market, a number of services. So the question there is not that we are over-dependent. The question is that we have to develop alternative markets, and that's a long-term process. At the moment, there are no alternative markets, really, which could take up the volume that we can export.
Wavelength, sparking the convos about Adelaide you should be having on Fresh 92.7.
That there was Amila speaking with Professor Hans Hendrischer from the University of Sydney about our future economic relationship with China. Later, we'll be continuing our chat about what Australia's economy could look like once COVID-19 passes.
Wavelength.
We'll be getting back into our story about Australia's post-COVID-19 economic recovery soon, but right now let's throw to Hamish to find out what the hell is going on in politics this week.
Going on in politics at the moment. Wavelength on Fresh 92.7.
Once again, the fallout from the Royal Commission into Sexual Abuse dominated headlines, this time focusing on disgraced Cardinal George Pell. The report found that Mr. Pell was made aware of active pedophiles and sexual abuse within the Catholic Church for many years. The previously redacted sections of the report were finally released this week, which found Pell had been directly told of the abuse by students and priests, but withheld the information from higher-ups in the institution. ScoMo has found himself under scrutiny as emails between the PM and former Minister Bridget McKenzie supposedly show his personal involvement in the now notorious sports grant scheme. The Labor Party has jumped on the opportunity to accuse Mr. Morrison of handpicking which projects received funding and of showing preference towards those in coalition electorates. Staying on ScoMo, the Prime Minister has called on the NRL to ban players who refuse to get a flu shot after a number of athletes came out as anti-vaxxers over the week and signed waivers exempting them from biosecurity measures. Scott Morrison implemented the no jab, no play rule in childcares when he was social services minister and is now pushing for a similar rule in the sporting code. Finally, a number of strip searches conducted by police at Splendor in the Grass has been found unlawful. The strip searches were performed on 4 underage teenagers and the officers conducting them made no attempt to contact the parents of the children as required by law. The officers in question also had insufficient knowledge and training to adequately conduct the procedure. And that's what the hell's been going on in politics this week.
Wavelength on Fresh 92.7.
Thank you for that, Hamish. Hope you're all enjoying the show so far tonight. Stay tuned for part 2 of Amila's story on what Australia's economy might look like in the coming months and years.
Wavelength.
The federal government has announced a raft of stimulus packages for businesses and individuals alike to help get the country through COVID-19. There's the increase to the job seeker payment. There's the brand new job keeper payment. There's plenty of relief for land tax, rent, and loan deferrals for businesses. It's historical in terms of the support the government has extended to the country. But what if this level of support was here to stay? Before COVID-19, the concept of universal basic income was often shrugged off as a fringe economic concept. Giving people money for nothing seemed ridiculous, especially in a society that rewards productivity over lifestyle. But now that unemployment is on the rise, and unlikely to come down for a while, universal basic income is starting to look like a particularly promising way forward. So is this an option the PM should be considering? Amila spoke with Dr. Jeremy Baskin, who is a senior fellow at the Melbourne School of Government, about the pros and cons of UBI.
Wavelength on Fresh 92.7.
Senior Fellow at the Melbourne School of Government, Dr. Jeremy Baskin, joins me to discuss the potential of a universal basic income in Australia and what it would mean for Aussies in the long term.
The idea really is to give each adult person in the country a regular payment, monthly, weekly, fortnightly, it doesn't really matter, a regular monthly payment that is unconditional and that they receive. The idea basically is to have a payment that takes away, number one, the stigma from current social security systems, so it takes away the conditionality. Number two, it recognizes the equal citizenship worth, if you like to think of it as a citizenship dividend. And number three, it allows a great deal more freedom when dealing with the changing nature of work in contemporary society.
What do you think are the common misconceptions people usually have surrounding UBI?
So the first misconception that it'll make people lazy, there really is very little evidence, in fact, for that. All the trials that have been conducted do not show that at all. The idea would be to give people a fairly modest basic income, and if they wanted to live a more, you know, a more luxurious life, then obviously people would go out and work. What they wouldn't do is be as inclined to accept nonsense jobs or casual jobs or ultra-exploitative jobs because they would have some basic income to fall back upon. The second misconception is that it's unaffordable. It does cost money. Whether it's affordable or not depends really on how much one's wanting to claw back the amount given out from those who are wealthier within society. So yes, it would require higher levels of tax for the wealthy.
Is it possible that taking on this UBI, it could establish a pattern of low pay and insecure work?
Some people would argue that probably it would have the opposite effect, because it would mean that you don't have to go and take any old job. So it would change the power balance between those looking for work and those offering work. The person offering work would have to make sure that it's appealing enough for people to take it, because they could always fall back on this basic income that they get on a guaranteed basis. It changes the whole nature of how we think about work. It stops work from being a chore to being a pleasure. It means we choose the things that we want.
Is a universal basic income a realistic model to help Australians through COVID-19 and beyond?
Well, I think if we'd had it before COVID-19 hit us, then we would have been things would have been a lot easier in dealing with the massive economic disruption that is happening at the moment, because we'd have a sort of a foundation of a basic system for survival on which people would be able to fall back. A number of leading economies are coming out of this current COVID period saying we're going to be introducing such a system. So, for example, in Spain, they've now put it on the agenda for the post-COVID era to try and transition to a system of this sort. Whether it's realistic for Australia, this depends a lot on political will. It'll have to be something that people want, people fight for, people struggle for. And what's really interesting is that in the current period, it's coming up as an idea from so many different groups, from both the left and the right, actually, who are saying this could be a way forward to cut through the present period and the post-COVID period.
Wavelength, sparking the convos about Adelaide you should be having on Fresh 92.7.
That there was Dr. Jeremy Baskin from the Melbourne School of Government talking about the concept of a universal basic income with Amila. A really great package there. I don't know about you guys, but a UBI sounds pretty good to me. But whatever you think about the UBI specifically, it is pretty clear that the economy is not working right now and potentially will never work like it used to pre-COVID. Maybe it's time to be a little bit experimental. I mean, what's the worst thing that could happen at this point, honestly?
Wavelength.
Right now we're getting into our weekly segment where Wavelength explains what has happened with the coronavirus this week.
Wavelength on Fresh 92.7.
Good news, everyone!
Yes, I know. I can't really believe it either, but it looks like we're finally starting to see a light at the end of the tunnel here in Australia, with the PM announcing on Friday a comprehensive pathway towards a COVID-safe economy by July. With restrictions now being lifted across the country, changing what we can and can't do once again.
Don't do what Donnie don't does. They could have made this clearer.
I know. As usual, it's confusing. So let's break it down together. ScoMo declared that restrictions would be lifted in three stages. Yes, we're talking stages again. Just this time, they'll be working in reverse. Stage one means that cafes and restaurants can now reopen, so we'll finally be able to head out to our favorite food joints again and continue taking pretentious photos of our meals on Insta. But we'll still have to wait a while longer for that first precious sip of a pint at the pub, as they're not slated to open again until we hit stage three.
No! God, please, no! 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 No!
Outdoor facilities, including playgrounds, skate parks, and outdoor gyms will also be reopened, but for many hoping to return to their happy place of pumping iron and making awkward grunting noises, there will be a longer wait, as gyms aren't set to open until stage two. The advice from Mr. Morrison for workers is to continue working from home if it's feasible to do so. So that means more Zoom meetings and no pants and cheeky sips of beer in the background. Just remember not to stand up.
The thing you don't realise is that there's good naked and bad naked.
And regional travel is now allowed within SA. So maybe think of making a trip to KI or Yorks and show our backyard some love, because we all know they bloody need it. I think I speak for everyone when I say this is some really, really good news. It's been tough living in a post-COVID world so far, but we're lucky enough to even be having this discussion while the rest of the globe continues to reel from the virus's devastation. We've even earned membership into what must be one of the most exclusive clubs in the world right now, the First Movers Group, which includes nations like New Zealand and Greece, who quickly responded to the pandemic. But what is the cost of returning to normalcy? Unfortunately, we've already started to see the effects of easing restrictions with the news of deadly outbreaks at an aged care facility in Sydney and a meat factory in Victoria, which have both led to a rapid cluster of new infections and even fatalities. And as we start to interact with each other again, it's likely we'll see more cases like this. Luckily, the time that we have spent in isolation so far has allowed our healthcare system to prepare for this, and we are well positioned to provide care to those affected without our hospitals becoming overwhelmed. We are by no means out of the woods yet, with researchers discovering just this week that the coronavirus has mutated into a second, more contagious strain, which is likely to undermine vaccine efforts.
Mother of God.
And SA even recorded its first new case in weeks on Thursday. It's not going anywhere. And this is why it's so important to remain vigilant. Now is not the time for complacency, so stay safe and stay away from each other. I know it sucks, but we'll be together again soon enough.
Wavelength on Fresh 92.7.
That there was Hamish letting you know everything you need to know about the coronavirus this week. Congratulations, Adelaide. We made it to phase one of restriction relaxations. We are so close to getting there. Obviously, keep up the social distancing stuff, keep washing those hands, and please download that damn app.
Wavelength.
Last week, we introduced a brand new segment called Heaps Good News. It made me so, so happy that I've decided to make it a permanent part of Wavelength. We all need a bit of optimism in times like these. Adrian has once again compiled the happiest news from this week for us all. Take it away, Adrian. I know
there's gonna be Heaps Good News on Wavelength.
This week's good news begin with Western Australia Police donating supplies and desks made by prisoners to help children being homeschooled during the COVID-19 crisis. Superintendent Jodie Miller, boss of a state prison, thought that finding a place away from the kitchen table for her children to study was proving to be a bigger struggle than she anticipated, and that many other families could be going through the same issue. This thought led into a community project in which 100 computers were donated as well as stationery packs to be distributed in the Mount Barker district. On top of that, Superintendent Miller asked her staff and inmates at Pardala Prison Farm to put together some simple school desks. The minimum security prison is unique to the region and has a focus on providing constructive work for prisoners reintegrating into the community. They managed to assemble 100 desks in less than 2 weeks. Despite COVID-19 hogging most headlines in relation to health news, there are big things happening completely unrelated to the virus. A major breakthrough has been accomplished in the fight against malaria thanks to Kenyan scientists who discovered a microbe capable of stopping the disease in mosquitoes. Dr. Jeremy Heron of the International Center of Insect Physiology and Ecology suggests that their data shows 100% blockage in the virus. The next step is to decide the way in which they'll spread the microbe in these regions where mosquitoes populations are infected with malaria. Currently, the methods being considered are either the release of spores in areas where mosquitoes may live, or to release a male non-biting mosquito implanted with a microbe, which would spread it then to biting females. It is important to mention that they've made sure that either approaches are completely safe for the mosquito population, preserving the delicate balance of the ecosystem. Other insect-related news take us to the Netherlands, to the city of Utrecht. This town has made an effort to transform over 300 bus stops into bee havens. The roof of these still-functioning bus stops have been covered with a low-growing succulent plant called sedum, a favorite of the pollinators, which also captures dust and rainwater. And lastly, a farmer in Queensland raises $25,000 for cancer research after his sunflowers become a sensation on social media. Peter Foxwell decided to sell some of the sunflowers he grows on his Alton Downs property near Rockhampton to raise money for cancer research. He, however, wasn't expecting the amazing response from the public, who came in non-stop during their long weekend. The visitors used this as an opportunity to take beautiful photos and wander around the sunflower paddocks. Mr. Foxwell said that all visitors had been respectful of social distancing rules during their visits.
Wavelength on Fresh 92.7.
Well, wasn't that a breath of fresh air? Thank you so much for listening. That brings us to the end of our show this evening. But make sure you subscribe to the Wavelength podcast on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or anywhere else you get your podcasts. You can listen back to our old episodes right now.
Wavelength on Fresh 92.7.
Love this podcast? Support it and sponsor today. Simply head to OzCastNetwork.com for details.